now the busiest A&E in the whole Northwest. We get about 94,000 patients a year through there. So we've got a major A&E department servicing the Wirral. That's not going to change. This is something where we're looking at something where we might have 25 or 30 and we're suboptimal. We are right up there as one of the busiest. Similarly, the Countess of Chester, whilst it's not the same size, is still very significant. They've got about 74,000 patients. So it's still quite significant. So you're not going to move away from two non-elective hubs. We might tweak a little bit about what happens in there, perhaps, but broadly speaking, you're going to have two major A&E departments no matter what. So this is about the elective activity. This is about planned things, planned procedures, and how can we avoid duplication and do something once rather than just duplicating it and doing it twice in perhaps an unsustainable way. And really, we're looking at orthopedics, ophthalmology, ENT types of services that would lend themselves. We're looking at Clatterbridge because it's a sort of symbolically halfway, if you like, it's not quite, but it's sort of between the two, and therefore it doesn't have any antibodies about people losing services, if you like. It's a kind of neutral zone. And it lends itself because our vision there is for an integrated healthcare type campus. We know that we've already got mental health provision there, we've got the Clatterbridge Centre for Oncology there already. Care homes there already. So I view that perhaps there should be a GP practice, there should be protected housing for the elderly, there could be a lot more day case work going on there that we do once rather than duplicating it twice. So I think that's a real opportunity there. And but in terms of back and middle office, it's quite modest. We're talking about shouldn't our HR departments work together? Shouldn't our IT departments work together? We happen, the Wirral, to be one of the global digital excellence centres nationally, and therefore, let's help the Countess of Chester get up to speed on IT in a way that they would take longer and it would cost them more if they were working in isolation, and that seems very reasonable. So we're talking about some relatively modest elective work and sharing that where we can, and back office, bit of procurement, bit of HR, bit of IT, and then middle office is what we call that, that's somewhere in between, so that's things like pathology, radiology, pharmacy, where we're exploring whether it makes sense to do something on a slightly larger footprint. That's broadly the substance of what we're talking about. This is the sort of things that I think if we weren't doing and exploring, somebody would ask the question, why are you not thinking like that, to be honest?
Okay, good. So can I just check, what are we to make of a statement in your last annual report on page 29 that says, and I quote, the Trust will explore the Councils of Chester the potential for the development of a single acute general hospital covering rural and West Cheshire within the next 10 to 15 years.
So I think there was a recognition that Allen Park was built in the early 80s to a 1970s design. And I think from talking to the Countess of Chester, it's got a sort of similar vintage. So there is a recognition that, for example, and some of you have experienced it, that in the summer, I have no air conditioning in Allen Park. So I can't isolate people very effectively. We don't have modern building management systems, temperature control, it's cold in the winter, it's very hot in the summer. I can't retrofit any of that because it just can't be done. It's a 1970s design. There was a recognition that says we'll have to look at the long-term options, and if we are doing more things together, at some stage we'll have to look at options about replacing parts of Owl Park, Clatterbridge, and similar to the Countess of Chester. So we'll need to look at options. And then one of those options would be, if we were looking to replace those assets in 10 to 15 years' time, one of the things we might want to say is, should we do it once? Now, the reality is that's a very significant oversimplification, because if you just take Owl Park, for example, it isn't a single asset that was built in 1982 and is now 2017, because the Women's and Children's Hospital is really new. We've just upgraded A&E, etc. But there are bits that really are very old and past their best. So I suspect when we actually look at it, we'll be saying, well, it isn't a matter of just replacing a hospital, it will be about replacing bits of it and keeping the asset up to date. But what we did see, and I suspect it's one of those things that has been sort of cottoned onto, and it's a bit more dramatic than we intended it to be honest, in that what we were saying is, we'll have to look at how we keep our asset up to date. And similar with the County of Cheshire, that one of the options we look at is, does it make sense at some point to do something together? The reality is, if you ask me now, I think what we would be saying is it would have to be a long time away for a start, and probably we would never be able to afford it, because a new hospital would cost £700-800 million, and we all know that that's going to be incredibly difficult to come by. But we did say, and as much as anything, I think it was to make sure that people were thinking as innovatively as possible. Personally, I think it just one of a range of options, and at this stage it looks to be completely unaffordable and would be well down the track. What we're more looking at is, as John's indicated, should we create a major elective centre that happens to do orthopaedic and ophthalmology work. Now that would be a much more modest expenditure, that might be a £5 million expenditure to do something like that. It's more likely that we try and do something of that nature rather than the extreme. But in 10 to 15 years' time, if we've not significantly refreshed our asset, we will have facilities that are no longer fit for purpose. So we are going to have to look at what the options are, and one of them would be to say, well, do we want to build something once rather than replace twice? But again, I get back to whatever we do, you've got a major demand on the Wirral, and you've got a major demand in the city of Chester, and that isn't going to change.
I get all that. You kind of helped me qualify that statement, and I mean this, with greatest of respect. I think that statement, written down in the annual, published in the annual reports, not qualified the way you have, does set all sorts of things. Because people have come to me to say, well, look what Aaron Parker's saying in the published annual report. So
I think the use of language
is important.
I think it's entirely fair to say that if I was sitting here rewriting it, I would write it in a slightly different way, I think.
Okay. I want to allow other people to have a say. Chris?
Can I just say, we all know that there's a massive increase in demand for the lack of funding from this government, who refuses to even acknowledge that there's a crisis. I think it is quite tragic. We've seen the widely reported stuff in the media. I'd like to thank John for coming and apologising maybe around the SDP, because I think the public has been really frightened by it. And I think David's explanation of, a little bit more around the hospital announcement report has been really helpful. But I would like to acknowledge that the Healthy Little stuff is really good stuff. We as a council are working really hard around integration. And to be honest, as far as I'm concerned, the sooner all budgets are pulled properly, that is the only way we're ever going to manage to meet demand. But we just have to carry on really with what we can do. But as a council, we are absolutely willing to join in.
Okay, anybody who hasn't spoken? Sue?
Yes, I think I'd like to sort of pull out a few principles here. I completely understand where you're coming from, the concern of the, as John said, the council's not being involved as much as we would have hoped in the development of this piece. But and we've been discussing resource and whether there should be more resource, which I understand is a conversation. But if we look at the fact that we have a finite resource, both
review for mental health and sets out the return on investment. And we've also seen some investment in through for mental health. We've got the perinatal services and the investment of 3.3 million across the SNP footprint. And we know what impact that will have, not just for people who are experiencing depression and severe mental illness during pregnancy, but for the long-term benefit for children and families, and the impact that that will have on future lives as well. So I think, you know, for mental health, I think we need to kind of acknowledge that it's actually there, and it's very clear, and the vision is very clear.
Okay, thank you.
Go on, Phil. Can I just come back first by thanking David for being frank and very useful, putting a better picture than we've got in the document. Secondly, to just help you about actual taking progress, Graham, if you can help. We were exploring intermediate care centres and other facilities, a bit like Mental Court, a bit like the one in Somerville in Wallasey, Housing 21 and other providers. We came across a bit of a problem because of changing rates for supported living and housing benefits and things that provided the elements of the cost of extra care that helped people live in those places and receive attention. David talks about potential things that might happen on the Clashbridge site. In my preview chair, you were talking in the Wirral plan about one sort of Wirral health economy and budget.
Wirral pound.
Wirral pound, thanks very much, Jeff. If the Wirral pound is bits of Wirral pound are shared between Graham and David to try and develop what might or might not happen in part of the Clashbridge site, to relieve some of the pressures in the system, I can see that as a perfectly logical process. And I wondered, because we're having trouble finding housing associations and providers to do things somewhere else, unless something's happened, apart from something that's proposed on the docks by Peel and so on, I'm not sure what that's up to, where there might be this dialogue that actually achieves some progress on aspects that's troubling us.
Can I just declare an interest as a director of the Centre that we're going to get into social housing and so on? We're not going to do that.
I won't mention any RSL to my name. So, thank you for accepting the answer to Phil's previous question, which is, of course, I suppose the main issue by the STP in its current form is it almost views NHS in a bubble on its own, isn't it? And actually, it's very much part of the whole place of Cheshire and Merseyside has a direct impact on the system of NHS. So that, you know, we're talking about people with whole lives of work and, you know, older people that have developed and, you know, people with lots of long-term conditions that have happened through the way that they live and all those sorts of things. So for me, if I was rewriting this plan in some way, shape or form, I'd be looking to talk to people about the NHS in that broader system, some of the impacts in terms of their health and well-being and how it all links up, as well as pulling out some of the issues in terms of the NHS. I think that might be a way to help us engage with people. And actually, a healthy rural agenda is much more about that, much broader place-based agenda. And of course, it sits within the partnership 2020. So we've got a cohesive place-based plan for Wirral, of which healthy Wirral is a part. But for the STP, we haven't got it in that way, and I think that's, in a sense, a shame then, because it does mean that straight away the conversations about hospitals and all of those sorts of things. But of course, we all know we want a system that isn't hospital-centric, we want a system that's about people and populations, and we want, when John starts off right at the start, he said, one of the big drivers here is the health inequalities that we've got in Wirral. But our job here at Health and Wellbeing is to improve health inequalities and to focus in on making everyone to have better lives. Within that context, there are some really important areas that we're working together on. But first of those is actually how we can pool resources to our single system. Because actually, my people and I spend an awful lot of time with David, and what we're doing most of the time is reacting to the pressures in the hospital system. But at the same time, we are having those conversations housing stock and how if we had more appropriate housing for the population, particularly the old people's population. And actually as a council, actually a number of housing organisations talking through the sector were interested in this. That's one of the key areas there. But of course, the relationship with David goes further than that, because we've got issues where, well, you know, our nursing homes, they're not that great, are they, really? If you're a nurse, why would you work in a nursing home? And it's actually quite hard to understand why people would do that. So one of the opportunities here, working with a big teaching hospital, is can we improve the quality of the people that work in the social care context in nursing homes, in residential homes, in domiciliary care, through improved training, through improved recruitment, all of those sorts of things. Because actually, if nothing else, the NHS has a really important brand, and it gets people in. So for me, there's a load of opportunities around those things, not about downsizing, but actually about upskilling. Social care is far less expensive than the NHS, but the quality is not as good. So how do you bring those things together? So that's what I would say. So there are developing plans. The whole extra care housing is on hold at the moment. It is being planned, and we should see some developments in the future.
John, do you
want to
talk?
Yeah, just to echo some of the points that the colleagues have just made. I'm really pleased with the progress we've made on Wirral in the last 2 years. We've got huge financial challenges. I think, to be truthful, we're a bit late coming to that point. Other areas have seen it greater than we have. But I'm really pleased with the relationships, the vision, the joint working, and the things that we put in place. That's not easily attained. And I think our vision is really quite well articulated. And so I'm really disappointed that the S&P might be seen to be going in the way of that, and it mustn't do that. So it's really important that we remain strong and that we remain completely committed to our health and wellbeing. So thank you for those comments, Chris. It's really, really welcome. It would be wrong of me to not mention that Wirral CCG is underfunded in terms of the formula. I put that in my report. So on the ACRA formula, which is a national formula for calculating CCG allocations, that Wirral CCG should receive £11.4 million or it does so. And that's a technical definition called distance from target. And because that 11 million is within 2% of our current allocation, it's deemed to be on target. But £11 million over a 5-year period is £55 million. And that starts to be a big sum of money when you're trying to do a plan for the next 5 years. And so I wouldn't want to miss that opportunity to mention that. But we do know, and this is why it's so important that our plans fit entirely for 2020. We do know that the wider determinants of ill health include employment, include safe environments, include housing. And that's why we do want to make sure that in our mental health part of our programme, we're grounded with the growth opportunities, the employment opportunities, the business opportunities. I sit as a member of the Rural Partners Board to make sure that we're considering further education
today would make sense, and you'd actually get a sense of that. So we're, or I'm privileged not to be here and listen to that, but it's, I think, maybe the Health and Wellbeing Board, or maybe those responsible for the SDP, needs to find a way to do something to say, well, I don't know how you feel about sitting in front of the camera, David, and saying about that, but it needs to be something like that, that actually could remove a lot of these misunderstandings, because it's a more personal communication.
Okay. Right. Move to... Let's move to some conclusions. Come on, Clare.
Yeah, we adopted this as our
plan.
Yeah. And so I think it is good that we need to use a focus on this, because this is not just about health and social care, this is about the broader health and wellbeing of the local population, and this is what we need to focus on. Because it will be picked up through the STP activity, will be picked up through health and wellbeing, and this is what it's about, so this is what we need to focus on.
Okay, any other points that... My suggestion in terms of kind of what we do from this meeting. I mean, I don't think it's helpful. I don't think it's appropriate for Health and Wellbeing Board to be used as a kind of political discussion. We do that at council, and that's the appropriate place to do it. So I'm kind of looking at some practical suggestions about how to move forward. I mean, I think the first one, which was a kind of recurring theme, I think, when we tabled today, was that we need to hold on to the kind of priorities in the Healthy Rural Plan, which has been agreed by this board previously, and they're up on the screen tonight. So I think if we could reiterate and reaffirm, if you like, the priorities in the Healthy Rural Plan, I think that would be helpful in terms of where we put our kind of energies going forward. I hope that's not saying that's not controversial. I think on the SDP, clearly there are going to be, it sounds to me there are going to be further iterations, because this has got issue version 4.4 on it, so it's presumably going to be another iteration. What I think would be helpful, and this is it's a kind of practical suggestion about what we might ask for, is, John, you talk about in your reports that an engagement plan is being developed for the next phase of public and stakeholder engagement. I think it would be useful that could be brought back here, so we see what's being proposed as a very practical suggestion, something we could hopefully add to.
Yeah.
Yeah. So those would be the two things that I would suggest that we could support tonight, which hopefully wouldn't be controversial.
Yeah, I wouldn't demur from either of those points. I think, yeah, we talked about that too early, which you would identify as our priorities, whichever priorities are. And having a look at the opportunity to feed into the engagement strategy and the wider plan. Is there a requirement, is there an expectation that this committee will note or acknowledge or whatever it is to the SDP, or is this, I don't know what your governance arrangements are. Are you supposed to have shared it with us a bit, or supposed to have emptied that you've shared it with us, or what's the governance process around these? Or is it out there, it hasn't said live, but there will be some engagement and it will iterate as we go. Maybe Nicola knows.
In terms of formal process,
those three.